Hi friends, welcome back to the channel. Last week I conducted a webinar for tech investors and there was a lot of interest in memory technology. But let me just tell you straight, the memory is dead. It's a fact and it will affect the entire industry. And this is a huge problem for Nvidia, Intel, Apple, AMD, and pretty much every chipmaker and startup. And this is really bad news because memory is essential for every CPU and GPU and every SoC. Now for the good news. There is a brand new memory technology which may solve this problem. And it brings us one step closer to a major boost in speed and reduction in cost. It's super interesting. Let me explain. Ever since transistors were invented in 1947, we've always found ways to shrink them down year after year. And we did a great job here because the first transistors were in the range of centimeters, then micrometers, and now we've progressed to mass producing chips at 3 and 4 nanometers. For example, Qualcomm's Snapdragon Elite chip is in 4 nanometer process node, and the latest M4 chip is in 3 nanometers. And recently, TSMC announced that they would be ramping up the production of chips in the new 1.6 nanometer process node. And you know what? For a long time, memory was also following this beautiful trend, but not anymore. It's over now, and this is a huge problem for the entire semiconductor industry. And here I'm talking about the fastest, so-called cache memory. Over the past 60 years, SRAM has been the memory of choice for applications where we need speed and fast access time. A typical SRAM cell consists of latches, which are built of usually 4 to 6 transistors. It's basically 2 inverters connected back to back, with the idea that one keeps the level of another alive. And this architecture differentiated from DRAM. So we love SRAM memory because it tends to perform better and also drain less power, especially when it's idle. It's the highest performing memory and it's integrated directly alongside with the processing cores. It actually stores the data very close to the processing cores, and here we still use the gigahertz range clock so we can access this data in the range of 1 or 2 nanoseconds. You see, this memory is essential. And here I wanted to make a memory joke, but I don't remember which one. And now it starts to get even worse because the general trend is that the amount of memory per chip is constantly increasing. If we look at the all recent chips developed by Intel, AMD, Nvidia, and Apple, all of them are adding more and more memory to their chips. For example, Nvidia is packing more and more cache into each of their new GPU, and they're making more and more cache. The problem is that cache memory doesn't scale as well as the logic, so it's keep eating up larger and larger parts of the chips. And this is really catastrophic for the future. Now, let's try to understand what exactly goes wrong here. In comparison to all other types of memory, SRAM is a part of the chip die itself, and it's fabricated in the same process node as the chip logic. The chip logic has more or less followed Moore's law, giving us approximately 2 times the transistor density with each process node at the same price. Unfortunately, memory cells doesn't scale at the same rate. It was at some point a factor of 1.8 scaling and then 1.6, 1.4. And with each process node, this number has gotten lower and lower until the point when TSMC announced their N3 process node. And at this point, it became crystal clear that SRAM scaling is now officially dead. The N3 node actually delivered a factor of 1.7 transistor scaling and a factor of 1.0 scaling of SRAM. This means SRAM cells stayed exactly the same size. And as we can see from this chart, bit cell size has an area of 0.021 micrometer square, which is exactly the same size as at their N5 node. And what's really sad, with their next improved N3B process node, it scaled by just a measly 5%. And this is actually not just a problem of TSMC, because Intel, Samsung, Global Foundries, everyone is facing the same challenges. To illustrate how bad actually things are, imagine an imaginary TSMC chip in 16 nanometers. And let's assume that 18% of the chip area is dedicated to SRAM memory. If we fabricate the same chip, the same design, in N3 process node, now SRAM area would occupy more than 30% of the chip's die. That's really bad. But now let's understand why this scaling doesn't work. Simply put, these memory cells are very special. Despite the fact that these cells are constructed from transistors, they have unique structure that does not conform to the normal logic design rules. For each new process node, it must be redesigned using special rules developed by foundries. It's a highly sensitive device, which is very vulnerable to the manufacturing process variations, for example, to variations in the cell threshold voltage or dopant fluctuations, and any of such variations can render the SRAM cell unstable and unreliable, affecting overall yield. This situation will not improve, but most likely will get even worse when we now transition from our FinFET transistors to a new gate-all-around transistor architecture. Because now we have to replace the fins with the nanosheets, and this introduces many new technical challenges. So I would say at this point of time, it's inevitable that with each new process node, SRAM memory consumes more chip area and driving up costs. From my experience in chip design, I can tell you that area is everything, and engineers are ready to go above and beyond, do extra mile to save every single micrometer square of area, because area equals money. You know, whenever we fabricate chips, we pay price per area. And the major issue here is that we actually can't do without SRAM. We cannot survive without enough SRAM, because if a processor core doesn't have enough SRAM, it has to retrieve data from further away. And this takes more power, it consumes more power, and also slows the speed, the performance. Let me know your thoughts on this problem in the comments. Before we jump in the new memory technology that may solve this problem, I want to show you something very exciting. This is their brand new ASUS VivaBook S15. And I was very excited to try it because it's their first Copilot Plus PCL laptop, which is based on the new Qualcomm Snapdragon X Elite chip in 4 nanometers. It has a dedicated NPU, neural processing unit, and it's capable of 45 TOPS. With this new chip, they're bringing generative AI capabilities to the laptop. First of all, it has a Copilot key, which I find very handy. You can instantly access the AI assistant, which can answer your questions, generate images, and create presentations for you. This is definitely the future of tech. Here, they've also introduced AI-powered applications to simplify your daily routine. Starting from StoryCube for organizing your large multimedia library, to ASUS Adaptive Lock that keeps your space safe by locking when you're away. It also features Co-Create, an AI-powered tool that allows you to draw images in Paint and then enhance them with AI. I've been using the ASUS VivaBook S15 for more than 2 weeks now, and what I can say, apart from its sleek design, it's a really capable laptop. So you can run LLMs with up to 13 billion parameters on the device. And the specs on this laptop are great. As mentioned, it has a Snapdragon X Elite chip, which is an ARM-based chip, paired with 16GB of RAM, a gorgeous 3K OLED display, and 1TB of SSD. And it has tons of ports, like HDMI, 2 USB-C ports, a microSD card reader, and 2 USB-A ports. I've taken it with me everywhere I go, and I'm really enjoying it. You get up to 18 hours of battery life, so I could even take it to my next transatlantic flight and work non-stop. So it's a really beautiful piece of hardware. Make sure to check it out using the link below. So, when we realized that we cannot scale SRAM memory any further, we found another option. Chiplets. Simply putting memory right on top of the cores. It was a huge deal back in 2022 when AMD introduced their V-cache technology. And this was huge because with that, we can manage to add much more cache memory. And here, we must give a lot of credit to AMD for their forward thinking. And of course, some of the credit goes also to TSMC, because AMD used TSMC's 3D SoIC, so-called system on integrated chips packaging technology, to make this to work. They basically stacked an additional 64 megabytes of L3 cache right on top of the CPU die. And this additional cache gave a huge performance boost to many applications, including gaming. In general, let's agree on one thing. This idea of stacking one thing on top of each other is brilliant, because this gives you an opportunity to mix and match different dies or different chiplets in different process nodes. For example, you can build a chip in the most advanced process node for the logic, and on top you stack a memory die in one of the older process nodes. In this case, we can benefit from the speed and transistor density and also power improvements in the core logic, and then use some bigger memory on top. And this memory can even be in the older process node, which means it will be more reliable and also much, much cheaper. And we see this approach adopted by more and more companies, not only for the cache, but also for other types of memory, as well as for other blocks, for analog circuits, for example. Because analog circuits also don't scale very well, at least not as well as digital. In this way, we can combine different chiplets manufactured at different technologies, let's say at 3 nanometers and at 16 nanometers, and build a chip in the most efficient way possible. The truth is that chiplets are great, and they may help us to reduce costs and add more cash, but it's not really solving the problem. That's why for a long time now, the industry has been looking for an alternative to current memory technology. So there are several emerging memory technologies, including magnetic RAM, ferroelectric RAM, resistive RAM, phase change memory, and others. I used to work with ReRAM, resistive RAM in the past. But what is so interesting about all these memory flavors? That each of them has their pros and cons. For example, some of them are more optimized for area or speed, some for power, some have faster access rates and higher bandwidth than others. On top of that, we know that each CPU or GPU features several types of memory, and each of them have different requirements. The main differences are in their data storage mechanism and the speed. And speed, as we know, for SRAM, is essential, because SRAM is the fastest, with access times in the range of a few nanoseconds, and it has to be low power. DRAM, of course, is slower. It's based on just one transistor and a capacitor, and here the access time is in the range of tens of nanoseconds. And we all know flash memory. Flash memory is the slowest. It takes microseconds to read the data from it. And then we also had to distinguish between volatile and non-volatile memory. So for example, SRAM and DRAM are volatile memory, which means they only retain data when the power is supplied. So now it's clear that when it comes to SRAM, the most critical things are latency, area, and power consumption. So in this new paper published in Nature, researchers at Stanford have developed a new PCM, so phase change memory material, called GST-467, that uses chalcogenide alloy in superlattice structure. And it's a great one in terms of the properties we are looking for. How does this phase change memory work? It's basically a memory cell that consists of a glass material which is sandwiched between two electrodes. And when we apply a high current pulse to it, it switches between the crystalline and amorphous states. And the crystalline state represents a digital 1 and amorphous state 0. And then, to read the data, we simply measure the resistance of this memory cell. And this new memory technology has really high potential, because it checks all our boxes. First of all, it has very fast access time in the range of a few nanoseconds. Second, it works at a low operating voltage, so it's compatible with modern processors. And then, according to the paper, it has the smallest dimensions to date, 0.16 micrometer square. And it's actually denser than, for example, TSMC's SRAM cells in 3N process node. I've actually made some back-of-the-envelope calculations, and from the area point of view, it's about 23% more area efficient. And this is Brilliant. The last important thing we always have to check with a new technology is scalability. And in this case, these PCM cells are compatible with a CMOS manufacturing process. So it seems it could be a contender for the ultimate memory. For example, it can be used for the L3 cache memory in configuration with the 3D stacking. Let me know your thoughts about it in the comments and consider sharing this video with your friends or colleagues who might be interested. Another important point here, apart of the fact that this memory technology is very dense, it's also a non-volatile memory, which may be a big plus for many applications. And on top of that, it has this unique property where each memory cell can store multiple bits. And this multi-level memory sounds like a dream, like a shortcut, you know? But not in this particular case. Here, we must consider that this property makes sense for analog in-memory computing applications only. And I will not go too much into the details here because I have many older videos explaining how this technology works. I just want to mention that we can't use these multi-level storage properties when we talk about cache, because then, instead of a single comparator, we need to use ADCs, and a lot of ADCs, and these will explode power consumption as well as the latency, which is so important here. Now, to the challenges. Of course, this is a brand new research, and there are many technical challenges remains until it can reach a widespread adoption. One of the challenges is integrating it in the current CMOS manufacturing flow, then reducing the programming current for the cells, and eventually improving reliability. But it's a great progress. So what I think is, there is a clear ongoing trend that we are packing more and more memory into chips. And this is becoming even more critical with the rise of AI applications. Despite the fact that SRAM memory is quite an old technology, it became the workhorse memory for AI. In fact, many AI chips rely on SRAM memory placed close to the cores. And exactly these types of chip architectures suffer greatly from this problem. I believe that SRAM technology as we know it won't go anywhere for L1, L2 caches, at least for the next couple of decades. So we will see it consuming more and more of chip area and money. Afterward, we will see new memory technologies coming first to DRAM and then to L3 cache as soon as they can achieve fast enough access time in the range of a few nanoseconds. Let me know your thoughts in the comments. Another way to address this issue is to look for different options how to bypass the cache. Of course, this won't work for a CPU, for example, but for some applications, it might be effective. For instance, in AI training, the training data is only used once, while the parameters should be accessible on chip. So here, we could find some tricks to operate without this classic cache memory as we know it. I think the current dead-end situation with SRAM will compel us to work on further innovations. And it's gonna be exciting, very exciting to follow. So I hope you will stay with this channel to stay up to date with the most important and critical trends in the microchip technology. Now, to support the channel, check out the new ASUS VivaBook S15 with the link below or by scanning the code here. Thank you so much for your support and for watching, and I will see you very soon in the next episode. Ciao!